Sowers. We're going to go ahead and begin our worship this evening with a word of prayer.
Our great and glorious God, seated upon your throne in heaven, Lord, we praise you right now. We praise you as a God who rules in all wisdom, a God who rules in all justice, and a divine wisdom and justice that knows exactly what we need in our lives. So often when we don't see it, you know exactly what you're doing, and we take such great comfort in that, and knowing that you're the one in control and it's not us. We're grateful that you're in control, and we look to you in all things. We look to you for our wisdom and our strength, and we pray that you would give that to us every single day, just enough for what we need, enough to be able to serve you, but not too much that we grow boastful and think it's just us. We know that you are our Lord and you are our God. We're so grateful for this time that we have right now to open up your word, to praise you with so many other Christians. Give us focus in it. Help us to have pure hearts and pure minds. We love you, God. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Our first song this evening will be Light the Fire.
I stand to praise you, but I fall to my knees. My spirit is willing, but my flesh is so weak. Light the fire in my soul.
Good evening. Is this volume good? All right. So I apologize for I'm having a little bit of sore throat. I hope that won't be much of an issue, but we'll get it through it together. Hey, college friends, let's dive into the exciting journey of maturity in Christ together, a path where our faith deepens, love shines, and wisdom guides us through the college adventure. Join me as we explore what it means to grow spiritually in this dynamic season of our lives. That was written by ChatGPT because I couldn't come up with a hook. So, my topic for tonight is maturity. Now, I did not choose to talk about maturity because I am a very mature person. No, just the opposite. It was because I took a look at my own life and saw the places that I was most sorely lacking. And I believe that all my failures can be traced back to a lack of maturity. So when I say some harsh words to you tonight, just know that I'm also speaking to myself. There will be two sections to my talk. In the first section, I want each of you to deeply reflect on your own faith. Are you a genuine Christian? And in the next section, I'll give you some tips on how both you and I can grow in maturity. Now, assuming that all of us are Christians and supposedly have faith in Christ, I want you to question your faith. What type of faith do you have? A saving faith or a condemning faith? Because even the demons believe, but they tremble. 1 John 2:6 says, "By this we may know that we are in him. Whoever says he abides in him ought to walk in the same way in which he walked." Are you walking the same way that Jesus walked? Jesus says in John 14:15, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments." Do you keep his commandments? You believe his gospel, but do you truly follow Christ? You accept him as your savior, but are you submitting to him as your Lord? Initially, we probably would all answer yes. We strive to walk the way Jesus walked, to keep his commandments, and to submit to him as Lord. But do your lives actually reflect your answer? I encourage each of you to check your heart and check your faith. Are you a real Christian? Be careful that you are not a Christian in name only. Last summer, I was working with a person, let's call him Elmo. So, after about 3 weeks with this guy, I was trying to share the gospel with another person at work, and when Elmo heard us, he said, "Oh, I'm a Christian too." I was speechless, and if you know me, I am never speechless. What did this guy say? He continued, "John says that we are in the world, but we are not of the world." At this point, I was like, is this guy serious? This guy thinks that he's not of the world? This guy who curses like the world, this guy who gets angry and yells at other people just like the world, this guy who's sleeping with his girlfriend and bragging about it just like the world? I'm sure you know someone like this in your own life. We look at someone like that and think, wow, how could such a person even think that they are a Christian when their lives are so contrary to their belief? But have you looked at yourself? Are you certain that you're not Elmo? Because with the same measure that you judge, it will be measured back to you. So therefore, bring out your spiritual mirrors and first take a close look at your own life. Consider this. If someone of this world, lost in sin and darkness, makes the same moral choices that you would, if there's no distinction between your behavior and the behavior of an unbeliever, what does that say about you? If I turn to the world and I hear a crew joking, then I turn to you and I also hear a crew joking, which I have. If I turn to the world and hear gossiping, and then I turn to you and also hear gossiping, which I have. If I turn to the world and see cheating in class, and then I turn to you and see cheating in class, which I have. I would start to think that maybe, just maybe, I'm not turning at all. I've been looking at two unbelievers this entire time. If you say crude jokes, gossip, cheat in class, and do all other things just like the world, and yet you think that you are a Christian, I dare say that you're no better than Elmo. Check your faith. Will your faith save you if your works are dead? Now, of course, it's inevitable that believers will still sin. 1 John 1, verses 8 and 10 attests that no one is without sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar and his word is not in us. It's true. Even genuine believers will still sin. But the difference lies in whether you are struggling against sin or whether you are completely subject to its desires. For example, if the U.S. Army sent me to fight a war against China, but instead of fighting against them, I hug them, I chat with them and I go back to China with them, the U.S. Army would rightly think that I was an American, but I was actually Chinese. I was a double agent. Because you see, you don't fight against your own side. So if God sends you to war against sin, and you come back without a single scratch, you either are as perfect and righteous as Jesus, or you didn't fight sin at all. If you come back from battle against the fiercest enemy of all the universe, sin, which drove Adam and Eve from the garden, sin, which caused God to destroy the entire world with a flood, sin, which killed a generation of Israelites in the wilderness, sin, which caused God to abandon his chosen people and send them into enemy captivity, and sin, which dragged the highest angel of heaven to the lowest pits of hell. If you come back from fighting against sin, and you did not have a single scratch on you, it's only because sin didn't recognize you as an enemy, but as a friend. It's because you aren't fighting against sin, you are living in sin. It's because you aren't on God's side, you are on sin's side. So therefore, rejoice in the struggle, because your struggle against sin proves that you are actually genuinely on God's side. And if you don't struggle against sin, check your heart, check your faith. Whose side are you on? It's very easy to deceive yourself into thinking you are Christians. After all, look at you. You're here at Sowers. You go to church. You hang out with Christian friends. You read the Bible every day. You sing praises to God. Look how devoted you are. You come to every Bible study, every singing, every church gathering. You're at every Sowers, every Woven, every Phileo, every Keenan, Crispell, Dilbeck, Longstreth, Weaver, you name it. You're there. You're at every spiritual event. You sure love God, don't you? Well, I hope so, but I'm not convinced that all of your hearts are on God's side. Now, don't get me wrong. It's great to go to these spiritual events, but remember what Jesus said in Matthew 15:8. This people honors me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. So let me ask you. You go to all these Bible studies. You're constantly engaged with Christians, the Bible, the gospel, but has it actually transformed your life? My fear is that many of you are like Judas. You see, he was constantly around Jesus, but he never knew Jesus. This is my fear, that many of you guys, you come and you hear, but you don't go and do. Don't just be a hearer of the word, go and be a doer. Because what does it matter if your lips praise God on Sunday, if your life doesn't glorify him on Monday? Do you sing and praise God in church, but gossip with your friends on the car ride back? Do you start your day reading the Bible, love God, love others, serve God, serve others? Then for the rest of your day, ignore God, hate others, and only serve yourself? When you reflect on your life, who are you serving? In your choices, who is the one being praised? Not who you say you're praising, but who is the one who is actually being glorified? Who is the master you submit to? Because if it's not God, it's going to be Satan, and no one can serve two masters. You either fully serve God, or you half-heartedly serve Satan. Because God doesn't need, nor does he accept, your half-hearted service. So I ask you again, where is your heart at? Are you struggling against sin, despising the sin in your life? Are you striving to walk the narrow way, striving to give your all for Jesus because he gave his all for you? Or are you not really bothered by your sin? Because God will forgive you anyways, right? Where is your heart at? Will your faith save you, or will it condemn you? You might be wondering, Michael, I thought you were going to talk about maturity, but you haven't mentioned it at all yet. That's because it'd be useless to tell you how to become mature if we don't first talk about why we must be mature. You see, everything I've just talked about, I've done. Not as an unbeliever, but as a Christian, I've done them. Crew joking, gossiping, immorality, cheating in classes, not that, I've never needed to. But hanging around Jesus, yet not being transformed by him, being a hearer of the word and not a doer of the word, as a Christian, I've done all of that. So then, why do I still think that I'm a Christian? I think that maturity is the key to answering that question. You see, the behavior of an immature Christian and the behavior of the people of this world, sometimes they overlap. So how do you tell the difference between them? And this is the difference. If you are an immature Christian, you will mature, you will grow up, because you are being sanctified by the Spirit of Christ who is transforming you into his image. But conversely, if you remain immature, perhaps it's because you are not a Christian. Now consider this. When you were born, you were a baby. When you were 1 year old, you were a baby. But if you're 5, 10, 20 years old, and you still are a baby, something's wrong. Some of you guys are spiritual babies. Now, if that's because you were born again yesterday, that's fine. But if you've been born again 5, 10 years, and you still are a spiritual baby, something's wrong. Because the key characteristic of a Christian is growing in Christ as the branches grow from the tree. If you are not growing in Christ, it's because you are not in Christ. Your branch is cut off. This is why maturity is so important, because this is God's will, that we would grow in Christ and bear fruit. In fact, God requires us to become mature, because if we are not growing, we will be unfruitful. And if we are unfruitful, we will be cut off. Jesus has no use for fig trees that don't produce figs, and neither does God have any use for Christians who don't produce the fruits of Christ's Spirit. So I know that I'm a Christian because I've grown. I was an immature baby, and now I'm an immature toddler. But you see, I'm striving to grow, to become a child, a teenager, and one day I'll become a fully mature adult. And as people who bear the name of Christ, our ultimate goal is to grow into his image and reflect his likeness. And now intellectually, we all know that. But the call of imitating Christ is so high, so impossible, that it's really difficult to put into practice. It's like asking a baby to run a marathon. So I'll give you three pieces of advice to consider: speech, action, and mindset. That'll hopefully help ground this goal in reality and hopefully help us to take some baby steps. One second. The first way we can be mature is in our speech. And there are two ways we can be mature in speech: avoid sin and pursue righteousness. Ephesians 5:4 says, "Let there be no filthiness, nor foolish talk, nor crude joking, which are out of place, but instead let there be thanksgiving." Now, since I've been at FC, I've heard quite a lot of filthiness, foolish talk, crude joking, and not a lot of thanksgiving. If I reflect on myself, I find my own speech to be sometimes crude, often foolish, and rarely thankful. Ephesians 4:29 says, "Let no corrupting speech come out of your mouths, but only such as is good for building up, as fits the occasion, so that it may give grace to those who hear." Now, one of the biggest issues I see with our speech is crude jokes. When you make crude jokes, what are you seeking? Are you pursuing righteousness and holiness? Because if not, you've already stumbled off the narrow way. Consider this. If you were together with your pastor and your friend, who would you seek to please? Would you make a crude joke to get a laugh out of your friends in the presence of your pastor? If not, then why would you make a crude joke to your friends in front of Jesus? Because Jesus is always here. If no one was there, just you and Jesus, would you make that joke? Because what matters in the end, whether your friends find it funny or whether God finds it funny? I think you know the answer to that. Now, guys, I have one specific request from you. I've been in enough conversations with you all to notice a pattern of speech that makes you really immature. Ladies, I apologize. I have not been in enough conversations with you all. So just enjoy my critique of the guys. I'll try and work on it. I don't know. Boys, listen to me. I say boys because if you are doing this, you are not a man. Three words. Stop saying gay. Oh, this is gay. Oh, the homework's so gay. The test is so gay. Ha ha, you're gay. Like, just stop. This is common. I say this because I hear this all the time. Just stop it. Unless you are saying gay as in homosexuality, in which case, be careful not to make light of a sin that Jesus died for. Unless that's the case, get rid of it. And while you're at it, why don't you also get rid of the "your mom's, that's what she says," and everything else that commonly characterizes the speech of middle schoolers? Because you're Christians, so act like Christ. If I wanted to hear the word gay in every other sentence, I would have gone to a worse school like Harvard or Yale or whatever. But I chose to go to Florida College because Florida College is a Christian community. You guys are Christians. You've crucified your old self of sin and have put on the righteousness of Christ. Or have you? If you've crucified the old self, then why do I still hear him talking? You babies better grow up. But it's not enough to just avoid sin. To be mature, we must pursue righteousness. Colossians 4:6. Let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how you ought to answer each person. What does this mean? Well, to be seasoned with salt is to be useful. Oftentimes, our speech is not seasoned with salt. Consider everything you've said today. Now take away all of it and leave only speech seasoned with salt. I bet most of you would have been pretty quiet today. I probably would have been pretty quiet today. Most of our conversations are just not helpful. Maturity is not just avoiding filthy speech, but actively seasoning our speech with salt. Maturity is making our words meaningful and useful. You probably already know this, but I blab quite a bit. And yet, I'm pretty horrible at seasoning my speech with salt. I know this is an issue I've been trying to work on personally. I've been trying to tell myself that unless I have something useful to say, to just be quiet and listen. I found Proverbs 17:28 to be particularly convicting. It says, "Even a fool who keeps silent is considered wise. When he closes his lips, he is deemed intelligent." So to grow in maturity, grow in your speech. Consciously orient your conversations around Christ. Don't just talk for the sake of talking, but talk in order to build each other up. Another way we can be mature is in our actions. And there are two ways we can be mature in action: avoid sin and pursue righteousness. You see a theme? Last semester, I downloaded a really popular game. In this game, you play as a pixel character, and your goal is to fight monsters, yada, 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 you know, standard game stuff. Now, in the home screen, you can choose different characters to play as. I was tapping on each character to see its stats. And when I clicked on one character, its character screen was an anime girl in a relatively sexual pose. She was not adherent to the Florida College dress code. Now, keep in mind, these are like 16-bit pixel characters, and there's no need for this extravagant character art anyways, and this game was rated E for everyone, so I don't know what that's all about. But after staying on that screen for probably a second too long, I clicked through the other characters. But after that, I found myself clicking back through the characters, trying to find that first girl that I saw. And then I caught myself. "Michael, what are you doing?" You know what I was doing? I was looking back. Luke 17:32, Jesus says, "Remember Lot's wife. Don't look back." Here I am, a new creation in Christ, having put on his righteousness and set to walk on his path with the goal of heaven right in front of me. And I look back to the enticements of sin. But Jesus said, "If your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away." So I deleted the game because it caused me to look back. If anything's causing you to sin, if anything's even causing you to look back to sin, cut it off and throw it away. Because sin's going to hell. Don't let it drag you along. But it's not enough to just avoid sin. To be mature, we must pursue righteousness. Now consider this. What do you spend your time on? And do those things help draw you closer to Christ? I also used to have this game called Clicker Heroes, where you click, and that's it. I would play this game all the time. My friend Reese used to tell me, "Michael, that is the worst game I have ever seen." And I would say, "No, I click and it's really, the monsters die and stuff, you know?" Well, one day I was checking my screen time and I realized that I was averaging 2 hours a day on this game. And honestly, Reese was right. It was a really boring game. So I deleted that game because sure, it's not causing me to look back to sin, but is it helping me look forward to Christ? You see, what can I not do when I'm looking down at my phone? What can I not do when I'm scrolling through YouTube shorts or playing video games? I can't look up. I can't see Christ. I can't look around me and see my brothers and sisters. Now, you'll still see me playing Clash of Clans, and when I finally get some friends, I'll play Minecraft with them. But there's a difference between taking time for yourself and letting these things control you. Are you controlling your enjoyments, or are your enjoyments controlling you? Because when you become a slave to these distractions, you are no longer a slave to God. Jesus can't be your Lord if you are submitting yourself to distractions instead. So in every moment, ask yourself, if Jesus were to possess my body right now, what would he do? And whatever Jesus would do is what you need to go and do. Because remember, it's no longer you who live, but Christ who lives in you. Finally, and most importantly, we can be mature in our mindset. In fact, I think this is probably the most important thing I'm going to say tonight. Your mindset will determine your maturity because the standards you set for yourself will change based on who you perceive yourself to be. Who do you think of yourself as? A college student? If you think of yourself as a college student, you will hold yourself to the standard of maturity for college students. College students are not very mature. Okay, well, maybe you're a Christian college student. You have a higher standard. You don't hook up with other students. You don't do drugs. You don't drink. You go to church on Sundays. Sometimes you even go to church on Wednesdays. College student, Christian college student. You see, the reason you are not mature is because your standard of maturity that you're holding yourself to is that of a Christian college student. And sure, you may currently be a college student, but you won't always be a college student. Raise your hand if you're a college student. This is actually a test to see who's still awake. All right, pretty good. Keep your hand up if you want to stay a college student for the rest of your life. If not, then who will you become? When you graduate and you're no longer college students, I'd imagine most of you would be husbands and wives, fathers and mothers, leaders and teachers in your church. Right now, I'm looking at a lot of college students. I'm looking at a lot less husbands and wives, fathers and mothers, leaders and teachers. And if I look in a mirror, I wouldn't see a husband or a father. I'd also see a college student. You see, there's a gap. There's a gap between who I am now and who I must become. And the ultimate job of this college student, more important than even his academic studies, is to become the husband, to become the father that he will be when he's no longer just a college student. His future wife, his future kids are relying on his current self. They are relying on this college student to not stay a college student. Because if I stay a college student, my future wife won't have a husband, and my future kids won't have a father. They'll only have a college student to rely on. And I dare say that my situation also applies to each one of you. So don't think of yourself as a college student, or you won't grow up. If you don't grow up, you are jeopardizing the people who will rely on you in the future. Don't hold yourself to such a low standard, because people are relying on you to do better. Now, if people are relying on us to have a high standard, how much greater the standard that God requests of his images? Now, spoiler alert, it's higher than I can reach. So consider this. Who has the highest responsibility? That would be God, wouldn't it? Now, you're not God, so you don't have his responsibility, right? Actually, you are created in God's image. Now, do you realize the responsibility that comes from bearing the image of God? I remember in middle school, when we went on a field trip, our teachers would always tell us, now make sure you are on your best behavior because you are the image of Valley Forge Middle School. Other people looked at us, but they saw Valley Forge Middle School. When we had the service event, FC Serves, last semester, we bore the name of Florida College, and we were the image of Florida College. Other people looked at us, but they saw Florida College. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. You are the image of God. All creation looks at you, but they see God. That's a high responsibility. What does God expect of his images? What is the standard that God holds his images to? Leviticus 11:44. For I am the Lord your God. Consecrate yourself, therefore, and be holy, for I am holy. And again, in the New Testament, Jesus says in Matthew 5:48, you therefore must be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. You may not have the highest responsibility being God, but you sure do have the second highest responsibility being like God. And your responsibility as God's image is to do what God would do. So what standard are you holding yourself to? You're not just college students. You're future husbands and wives, future fathers and mothers, future leaders and teachers. And you are always God's image. Maturity is realizing that you are to hold yourself not to this standard, not even to this standard, but to the highest standard, because that's the standard that God holds you to. Now, if you truly understand this, maturity will follow. Because no one who thinks of themselves as an image of the holy and perfect God goes around making crude jokes. No one who thinks of themselves as a reflection of the holy and perfect God flirts with sin. In contrast, anyone who understands their responsibility to be like God will instead strive relentlessly after the holiness and perfection of the God that they reflect. Now, I want to conclude with a few big picture thoughts, just a sort of exhortation to us. The Bible describes your life as a race. When you were baptized into Christ, you were transferred from the kingdom of Satan into the kingdom of God. Before, you were in darkness, but now in the light, you can see a narrow and straight road from your feet extending into eternity. This is your path. This is your race. You're called to run the race with endurance, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of your faith. Now, how do you persist in this race? How do you stay rooted in Jesus and avoid falling away, shipwrecking your faith, as so many others have done? How do you stay on this narrow road when everything around you is trying to push you off? Now, I think the answer is quite simple. You can't run forwards while you're looking back. If your eyes are not set firmly on the goal of Christ in front of you, if they look back, if they even just look to the side, you will trip and you will fall. If you forget why you're running your race, you'll grow weary and you'll stop and you won't finish your race. So to run your race with endurance, you must firmly set your eyes on Christ. Keep your eyes on Christ. Christ was your starting line. Christ is your finish line. Christ is the way that you walk on, and Christ is the strength by which you walk. Keep your eyes on Christ. Don't look back. Don't even look to the side. Keep your eyes on Christ. Keep your eyes on God. And finally, the mark of a Christian isn't a lack of sin. It's the struggle against sin each day, each hour, each moment, crucifying yet again the old man and its desires. And by the grace of God, picking up our miniature crosses and running after Christ. We stumble, we fall, because unlike Jesus, we are unable to walk on the water that he walks on. But like with Simon Peter, Jesus reaches down and pulls us up to walk with him once again. So keep your eyes on Christ, and by his grace, you'll walk with him. And one day, you'll finish your race, you'll cross your finish line, and you'll enter into his eternal kingdom. I want to thank the Silver's officers for this opportunity to speak, and thank you for your attention tonight.
Before you have promise, I'm going to speed this up just a tad.
Oh, Father, draw.
Come now, my spirit, peace. Our God in heaven, thank you so much for the beautiful day that we got to live through. Thank you for being with us through every moment, and thank you for this moment tonight that we have to listen to Michael and listen to encouragements and exhortations from your word. Thank you for our voices that we have to sing praises to you. It's encouraging to us, and our prayer is that it glorified you and that you were pleased to hear our voices tonight. Thank you so much for all of the good things that you pour into us every day. You are a good shepherd, and as in that role, you only take care of us. And that doesn't always look the way that we think it should, but we are learning to trust in your goodness more and more every day. Thank you for tonight once again. I pray for everyone here and everything that's going on in their lives. For the good things that are happening, I pray that they're able to see you in them. And for the hard things that are happening, I pray that, again, that they're able to see your work in it and draw closer to you through it. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Okay, three announcements. First is Ian Lackman is here. Everyone look back and say, hi, Ian. Okay, Ian is here because he is collecting things for Isaac's care package. And we've been announcing that for a little bit. So if you have anything for him, a letter or origami or a knit hat, as Bryce announced, he's here for that. And so you can just bring it to him. And I think he's just putting it in his car. Second announcement is, a week from tomorrow is, I think it's FC Bound, and there's a Davis Island singing going on. So that's going to be super cool. So you're going to want to go to that. That's a week from tomorrow. And then the last thing is, it is the season for electing new sowers officers. And so tonight we had our informational meeting thing, and we are aware that not everyone who is interested in running was there tonight because they had other things going on. So, one, if you're here and you weren't able to be there for that, or if you know someone who's interested and wasn't able to be here for that, it's okay. We're going to be up here in the front after SOARS if you have questions or anything, and we want you to come talk to us about that. Or if you know someone who isn't here, just tell them to reach out to us. Like, we're there for them, and if you're interested in running and you weren't able to be here, it's okay. But, yeah, and then my request for all of you guys is, please remember to say a prayer for the selection process and for next year's officers, because that's a really big deal. And we all have faith that God is working through sowers, and so pray that God is with the people that are running and that God's hand is in that. Everyone have a good night.